fourth year both on the Zebra Coins and on First.
I'm Forrest. This is my third year with both.
I'm Mikel. This is my first year with both.
I'm Mason. This is my first year on the Zebra Coins and my sixth year with First.
So you might be wondering, what is FIRST? FIRST is an organization that allows students from ages 6 to 18 to participate in STEM-related activities and robotics competitions. There's competitions for all ages. There's FLL Junior, FLL, FTC, and FRC. FIRST was started in 1989, and since then they had over a million students, and they offer $20 million in scholarships each year to students. Additionally, FIRST encourages the concept of cooperation, which basically means that our team is encouraged to help other teams build up their team, build up their robots, and just support their team overall each year.
So who are we? Our team was founded in 2002, initially known as Team Infinity. We rebranded to ZebraCorns after we started accepting students outside of the North Carolina School of Science and Math. Our stripes represent that our team is now open to everyone. Our team is composed of 44 students, and in the 6 weeks of build season, we managed to accumulate over 6,000 hours. Our team accepts students from a variety of socioeconomic backgrounds, cultures, and genders. In fact, 50% of our leadership team is female, and 80% of our drive team is female.
So, in our past year, we were able to win a lot of awards. But the two highlights of our season were winning at the state championships and winning the Chairman's Award at one of our district events. And the Chairman's Award is the most prestigious award that you can win at a FIRST competition.
The game this year is FIRST Power Up. Teams score points for their alliance by placing cubes upon scales and by climbing at the end of the match. Our goal for this year is to optimize the amount of points by designing a robot that can accomplish both tasks.
So we take strategy very, very seriously on this team. And that means we have a small group of people that split off right after the kickoff and really mathematically cut apart the game and analyze it. So that means taking each different action you could do in the game, evaluating how many points you can get by doing that action, and then pinpointing which actions are key. This year we pinpointed that placing cubes on the high scale level is the best strategy because you get the most points basically per cube, and cubes are a very limited resource. Based on this strategic analysis, we also form a variety of different priorities and design requirements, such as the speed of whatever mechanism we're using to bring the cubes up and down. However, we don't necessarily we don't pinpoint mechanisms at this phase. We just focus on what goals we wish to accomplish. This analysis also helps us later in the season when we start to think about in-match strategy, and we continue this by looking at what other teams are doing and by what's called scouting them, which is watching them in matches and analyzing that in order to evaluate the capabilities of teams as well as find innovative new strategies we can apply.
So our programming team has made a couple of big changes this year, and one of them was the introduction of ROS, or the Robot Operating System, to our entire robot code. So ROS is the framework of our robot. We use it to communicate between the processors and the sensors on our robot. Since ROS code is organized into discrete units, it also makes it easier to integrate our computer vision with our control systems code. So along with offering us more flexibility, it also offers us software for visualizing sensor data. One of the things we use that for is SLAM, or simultaneous localization and mapping. So basically, the robot uses a sensor to create a map of its surroundings and then place itself on that map. The sensor we're using is called an RP LiDAR, and so it's a laser sensor that spins 360 degrees to get a map in every direction. You can see in that image, that is a map that the RP LiDAR created of our lab just a few weeks ago. Beyond just mapping, we can also integrate with ROS software to enable autonomous path planning and even obstacle avoidance. So we place a point some distance away from the robot and it can autonomously drive to that point, even avoiding things that are in the way. So as you can tell, ROS is an industry-level software that is really enabling us to do things on our team that we haven't done before. And I'm excited to announce that as of our most recent competition, we are the first and only FRC team to successfully implement ROS on our entire robot code.
So in addition to just implementing ROS, we're also doing a bunch of other cool stuff. So we're using an optical flow sensor, which is basically a tiny camera that you can point at a flat surface, or in our case, we're pointing at the ceiling, and it can keep track of which pixels it's seen, and as the camera shifts, which pixels were in a given location. and then keep track of the robot's velocity and position over time. That sensor is going to help us keep track of where the robot is in the field, which will help with pathing and other things that we're working on. We also are using a stereoscopic camera, which is a camera but with two sensors. It allows it to see depth, much like how you can see depth with your two eyes. So that stereoscopic camera allows us to build a map of the field.
There we go.
As well as being able to locate the positions of objects in the field more precisely. Because when you just have one camera, you can only really get a sense of the position of the object left and right, and you can kind of get depth by looking at the size of the object, but it's difficult. We're also doing a bunch of stuff with dynamic arm collision avoidance, because our hooks for climbing are actually in the way of the arm, so we have to keep track of the hook's position over time and the arm's position over time to make sure that there's never a collision. And whenever a possible collision is detected, the arm is automatically routed around so that a collision can't occur and we don't have issues there with the hook getting tangled and then broken and causing all kinds of other problems. So for controlling the arm in the elevator, we're using something called motion profiling. This is basically knowing how a mechanism can possibly behave and its maximum possible limits, and trying to be right at the maximum possible limits at all times, but never going beyond that. So we know the position can change with a velocity, a maximum velocity of this, and we know the velocity can change with a maximum acceleration of this. We can use that to construct smooth profiles for our mechanisms so that they're always smooth, never exceed the bounds, and don't draw more power than we want them to. We're also using this on our drivetrain in a more complex way, because like a drivetrain, like your car, you can't just always be traveling in a straight line in the same way our elevator can. You have to path around. And when you're doing curves, you can't go quite as fast as if you're going in a straight line. So we take this into account, and we actually use physics to calculate for the velocity of our robot and take into account curvature as well as the spinning of the robot, because that slows how fast it can translate. And we're using quintic spline paths in order to do this. So basically we have a system for generating paths that are as intricate and as complex as we need, and then we can have the robot run over those paths. Another cool thing we're doing this year from the programming side is haptic feedback. So we're doing all these cool things with the robot, but at least at the moment we have a driver, and we need to make sure the driver can get the information they need and be able to control the robot at the maximum level they can. So haptic feedback is basically one way of getting that feedback to the driver. We have little vibrating motors that we have in a vest that we put on our driver, and we've hooked up to various different pieces of information we get both from the field and also from the robot, so the driver can get a sense for, okay, what time is it right now on the map without needing to look anywhere or read anything. We're also planning on using this to feed the driver back the exact position of the arm so they can get a better feel for that, even if it's difficult to see, and the current voltage usage of the robot, so that when they're exceeding the bounds and the robot is what's called browning out or repeatedly failing to accomplish something because the processor is losing voltage, they can actually feel that and stop that immediately rather than having to actually think about it. And one of the cool things about haptic feedback is that it can be very intuitive. It's sort of like how you know your arm is here. When you hook up a system to someone that has that is always doing the same thing, they can learn that and not necessarily even understand what it's doing, but they can intuitively understand how it works.
Beyond sort of integrating our driver more closely with information flow from the robot, we're also pursuing other ways of improving their skills and abilities. So we actually built a full virtual reality simulation of the robot in the field. And so we don't necessarily have enough space to build a full 50-foot field in our lab. But this gives us the opportunity to put them in and actually have them drive the robot around. And so this is done within Unreal Engine 4, which is a game engine, though it's also used for things like animation and architectural visualization. We use it for driver simulation, and sort of the most important factor in that is that the robot moves realistically. So we have physics simulation of the drivetrain, where each individual wheel and its interactions with the ground are carefully modeled, and the resulting forces from rolling and slip and things like that are then applied to the robot. So we can use this for other things besides just driver training. we can use it for figuring out sort of how the game works before we ever get to a competition. So we can stick 6 robots in there with different drivers and have them go through and play a couple of matches, and we can see what happens. And then something potentially further down the line that we haven't had a chance to do yet, but we really hope to get to, is we can use it to test high-level AI work for the robot. So not necessarily figuring out where objects are, but figuring out what to do once you know where the cubes are. So where do you, or the other objects in the game, where do you want to move the robot? What action do you want to perform? And this gives us an opportunity to do that without having a physical robot moving around, which also improves safety in a variety of ways. We don't want to have an untested system controlling a robot that we don't necessarily know what it's going to do.
So mechanical team's job at 900 is to build a robot that allows programmers to do everything that they want to do and have programmed and designed to do. So our main task is to make sure that whatever our strategy comes up with, we can accomplish and do repeatedly and efficiently. So how do we do that? Our requirements are set by our strategy team, and we get the set amount of tasks that we're supposed to do with our robot. And from there, we build a framework to decide exactly how we're going to do those things before we actually talk about any mechanisms. After that point, we do actually split off more into groups and talk about each mechanism. And we research those. And we do that by looking at what other teams have done in previous years and also what's done in industry to complete tasks in similar manners. Once we've done that, we go into the prototyping stage. And there we take different ways that we've researched, and we actually build them and test them out on the objects that we're going to be manipulating. So this year was cubes. We went through different iterations with different wheel types, from RC car wheels to almost spoke lights, and we settled with some really squishy, like foam-like wheels. So before we do any actual building, once we've done prototyping, is we'll CAD a robot, which is computer-aided design. We use SolidWorks to do all of that. Basically, what that allows us to do is everything that you saw in our robots earlier, that was all within a computer program before anything was actually put together for our final robot. And what that allows us to do is we can design a part that you can't easily manufacture, and we can print it on one of the printers we have here, or we can send it to some of our sponsors to be able to CNC cut them on laser cutters, water jets, or the ShopBot at the lab. With that, we are able to get a lot more precise than we can do here, and we can also look at the CAD and make sure that whatever we're building, we can actually assemble within the time frame that we're given and within the constraints of the robot requirements. So after that, we actually have to build the robot, and that usually goes pretty well, but the CAD is definitely a big thing that allows us to do that, and it helps with making sure that we will be able to do a task without our robot breaking, as we're able to simulate certain stresses on our parts to make sure that nothing will bend or break or snap without testing.
So with all that goes on within our team, we want to make sure that we're able to maximize our team's efficiency to reach our goals. As you can see from this map here, in the past 5 years, we've had students from over 50 cities in North Carolina. And with all this reach comes a lot of different diverse students within our team. And because of this, we're able to accomplish some very great things. Because of our affiliation with the North Carolina School of Science and Math, we actually work as a 501c nonprofit organization, which means that we have to make sure we allocate our funds to empower our community to be the best it can be. So it's not just fundraising money to build our robot, it's also raising money to make sure that we're coordinating various outreach events within our community. So we're very active in the Durham community because we believe that younger generations of students should be given the equal opportunity to experience STEM in a tangible manner. So we've had partnerships with schools like E.K. Poe, Creekside Elementary, as well as Southwest Elementary School. So just a few weeks ago, we went to Southwest Elementary School to work with their fourth grade students in their Shark Tank competition. So basically, this was a blend of entrepreneurship and robotics. So fourth graders were making products such as a smart water bottle, as well as a color-changing t-shirt. But we're also the third oldest team in North Carolina, and because of this, we wanted to make sure that other teams are able to be as sustainable and have the resources that we have on this team. So because of this, we partnered with the North Carolina School of Science and Math to start a TIGER program. So basically, we worked with three rookie teams in the North Carolina area. A lot of them were from some underprivileged areas. So we were able to work with these teams to build these teams up and give them the head start they need to be successful in the first robotics competition. But our reach in the community doesn't just span with North Carolina. We're actually very involved in the international community. So we have these things called white papers, which basically document how to do things like vision, neural networks, and virtual reality, and all the other things that goes on within our team. So because of this, teams in Israel, the Netherlands, Poland, they're all able to access our white papers and then implement some of our technologies within our team. So we think that's really cool because we've been able to work with teams from Israel, the Netherlands, just from our lab space here. So, well, one last thing is that we'd like to invite you to all of our competitions this season. We have one coming up in the, not this week, but the next weekend at Pembroke, UNC Pembroke. So we'd love to see if you guys there, if you guys can make it. And we'd love to have you guys there. So any questions?
Thank you guys so much.
Thank you so much.